Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
I want to say greetings to each and everyone today. Give God thanks and praise again for allowing me to be here. I must say thanks to God for the sponsors and also for the staff and management of MTV. As I don't know how much of you all are really seeing what is really happening presently now on the world stage, but you know, we in Grenada here always say because our country is small and there's not anything much significant that is happening around us more than the what you call isolated incidents. We're not really understanding the seriousness of the word of God and in essence of the prophetic word. You know, and I personally have a serious issue now, and I would say I'm troubling my spirit to recognizing that what is happening on the international stage. And we are in Grenada here as ministers and leaders of churches, not taking the opportunity to use. At least, yes, we understand it costs. But I personally think, I'm not advertising, but I personally think that MTV is very efficient enough that, and they would make it available that we can come here and sit as ministers and have a good discussion, enlighten the nation and even our people. And it was surprising to know that even what is happening presently now, not even discussing in churches, like leaders have not seen it as anything significant to be speaking about. Right? And that touched my heart because I always say it's one of the things that I'm looking at from my years of experience that many churches, because they may found on a specific scripture in the Bible, that's all they surround the whole Christian life about. So they're not focusing on nothing else, and unless you're not in that category of the lifestyle, you are not qualified, you're not worthy to be a brother or sister of this. I recall that I was at my home on many occasions, but two organizations I really want to highlight here. One that many of you all know who goes around every day at least and offer you tracts and whatnot and then speak to you about their religion. Not about God, about their religion. And they would tell you bluntly that if you're not following their religion, that you are serving Satan, you know. And then a next one came on one time and tell me if I don't calling my religion, my death, by that specific name, that, you know, all of us is serving the devil. Because we don't have to stress ourselves on religious belief, a church, our organization. What we have to look at is what the word of God says to us and where does it really significant to us as every believer. I believe in, as I know I grew in the Open Bible Standard Church, and one thing I have known for sure that we had upkept up to as much as possible, that we study from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation. We never skip anyone. We teach people out of that specific book because this is what God has sent to us. He would not have given us the Old Testament if there was no significant situation or anything there for us to learn from it. Or he would not have given us the New Testament if there isn't anything that we should be looking onto it. He put both books together so that we can study his word and understand who he really is. So I pray today that many leaders would really take a step up in their life. Because one of the things I have seen that Paul said, we're not only a pastor, we are pastor teachers. So we're not only to come on the pulpit on a Sunday morning or a Sunday night or whensoever and just preach to people. He expects us to teach people. I mean, in the Old Testament, God have said that to Moses, that you teach your children, that they will teach your children. Even in that whole aspect that when God was giving Moses that command, that, you know, he said he should write it upon the forehead. You know, when I look at the word that really mean to that, he speaks about these children supposed to have these things all in a bag wheresoever they go. And we today, we're not even doing justice to the Word of God, because we're not even taking much time to even teach in our local assembly, much less to take time to teach the people out there. But I thank God. And I also want to say here this day, I thank God for that, because God knows who you are. I remember that God has spoken to Jeremiah, that when Jeremiah had an encounter with him, Jeremiah tried to divert from the call that God have called him to, and he tried to say to God, "It's not me." And God said, "Look here, now, I know your sin before you're born, and since before you enter your mother womb, I knew you. And since before you're born, I sanctify you." So God knows. And today I can share many experiences where I know that God have walked me through this life. And I thank God for that. I used to say to myself that, you know, when I was much younger, that God have allowed me to be so, get so many information across the globe. But it seems like there's no way to share that sort of information that I have. You know, and at one time it feels like a woman pregnant and she's ready to give birth, but it seems like it's not coming through. The pain is still there and said crying out for deliverance. I thank God today that our sponsors have come and not resided in Grenada, but came and visited my local assembly. And within the sponsors and God had acknowledged, you know, as I look in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12, where he said, "It is him, you know, that see me worthy and counted me to come into that ministry and allow that sponsors, the sponsors to sponsor that television ministry that I am today, so that I can speak not only to myself and neither to my home or to my local congregation, but across the globe." And I thank God also that MTV have always make it available that I can be here. I can say to everyone that when I come here, I feel at home. You know, I walk in this place without fear and looking at any retribution out of it, no rejection. And I thank God for that. I continue to pray that even the staff and management of here would turn their heart to know the Lord Jesus Christ before it's too late. Really want to give God thanks and praise again for allowing me to be here, that I can share his word. Brothers and sisters, I can tell you I had an encounter with God. And an encounter I had with God is one that Jeremiah spoke about. That, you know, sometimes you don't want to speak. You want to shut your mouth. When you see what's happening, you want to be silent. But as Jeremiah said, it is like fire in my bones. I cannot keep silent. Because God said, "I put it into your mouth. I put that into you that you cannot keep silent." He said, "Don't fear the faces." He said, "They will make the face hard as iron and like pillars." But he said, "He will make yourself even more harder that you'll be able to speak, thus said the Lord, because he have given you the boldness to speak the word." And today, I thank God that he have given me that boldness that I'll be able to say, "Thus said the Lord," and God have given me that authority over every situation that I can speak, "Thus said the Lord," this morning and today. I give God thanks and praise again. Today I want to look at a topic that, are we ready? You know, and it's a very important topic that I want to touch on this day. The reason for saying that, I'm not only speaking here to the unsaved, but I'm speaking to also the churches that is out there. Are we ready for the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Because many of us sometimes, even when you look around, it's like we're going to sleep. We live just as normal, carnal-minded, and worldly, and not recognizing. I don't know how some churches or how some pastors are preparing the flock for the return of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But if, as I always say, if you go back into the book of Matthew chapter 24, you have seen what God himself have done. He have put his disciples sit down and teach them and show them the signs that what will be before us, before his second return. And one thing that he said in Matthew chapter 24 verse 44, "Be ye ready, for an hour ye think it not." And this is something that is taking many by surprise. And today I want to say straight out, up front, that we as believers, we are not doing that what God called us to do. We are not shining that light. We are not being that salt that he has called us to be. We are sometimes, even in our local assembly, we still what you call racial among ourselves. We go along inside our local assembly. Sometimes I love to and I prefer to. And there are people who cannot, we will not hold certain conversation with, because there are sins that are not qualified to be in my standard. God did not say it so. Brothers and sisters, after this flesh have gone back to the grave, into the dust, every soul in front of God is like a soul unto him, nor rich nor poor, because he spoke about it. You know, every one of us would have to stand before him. The richest man on earth, if he don't know the Lord Jesus Christ and he died today, he's as poor as anyone on the street today. And the poor the poor man right now in any country that died, but he died in Christ, he's as rich as any one of them. We have gotten the example in the book of Saint Luke, the gospel, with the rich man and Lazarus. And it shows us that. But yet for all, we're not listening, we're not picking up, we're not understanding. The Bible said, ever alone him or never come into the reality of what God is wanting to say to us. Today, as I said, I want to teach us, show us from the scripture, we are not ready for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. A matter of fact, you hear many people saying, this is not something that is common among believers today. Not even teaching from the pulpit. We don't even take time out to speak about the awesomeness and the gruesomeness of the spiritual life. The awesomeness of what God is preparing for us and the gruesomeness that many would go and spend life everlasting. Like eternal damnation. The Bible said that where many would go there. Because you say, wide is the road and many enter thereof. We always talk about the warm diet not, the fire quench not. And we are not teaching that. We're not letting even our believers understand that we need to be ready for our they think it not. I want to look at the book this day, Daniel chapter 9 from verse 5. But before I do so, let me lift up this session here in prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you today for your mercy and for your grace. I thank you for the authority that you have given unto me, O God, Lord, that I can come here today to speak thus said the Lord. Lord, you have spoken to Jeremiah, Ezekiel. You're speaking to Isaiah and Daniel, O God, Father, Lord. These are men who have personal encounter with you, O Lord. And when they see, O God, what your judgment is for this earth, O God, Father, Lord, they cried out, O God, Father, Lord, for mercy. They plead, O God, Father, to the people to turn from the disobedient ways, O God, and to turn to you. But here are we today, O God, Father, not even focusing, not paying no attention to what is happening, Lord. We are going about just life as normal. But Father, I trust you that you will help us, O God, Father, that we'll be able to grasp, O God, and to get ourselves ready before your second coming. Bless each and every one of us today, O God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. As I said, I was looking into the book of Daniel chapter 9 from verse 5. And it read thus, we have sinned and have committed iniquity, and have done wickedly, and have rebelled, even by departing from thy prospect and from thy judgment. Neither have we hearkened unto thy servant the prophet, which speak in thy name to our king, our prince, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. O Lord, righteousness belong unto thee, but unto us is confusion of faces, as at this day to the men of Judah, and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and unto all Israel that are near and that are far off, through all the countries, whether thou hast driven them because of their trespass that they have trespassed against thee. Now I want to point out one thing here, because many who don't believe and who sometimes try to categorize the scripture and use it in context, let me say here this day. This scripture here, this word here, speak of Israel. Some of them would want to say to us that it was speaking to the time of Israel. But he said, we are Israelites. We are of the commandment of Israel. We are grafted in. So if he speak to Israel back there, and he say, all who are near or far, from you know, far and wide, different countries, is speaking to us as believers. We need to understand that. We need to get to know that God is speaking to us just as he speak the word to Daniel for the time back there. Here he says in verse 8, O Lord, to us belong confusion of faces, to our kings, to our prince, and to our fathers, because we have sinned against thee. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him, neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God, to walk in his law, which he set before us by his servant, the prophet. Now, Daniel, and I will show some commentary here, some footnote. Daniel was, as we would say, was one of the prophet, or one of the men, Israelites, who was brought into captivity. Right? And by he being into captivity, he had recognized that he's in a strange land, but he keep the command of God. And here he understand after 70 years that the children of Israel, God had promised that they would return back onto their homeland. But he now did not see that the time has come only for them to return back unto the homeland. But what he has seen also, they was not ready to enter back into the promised land. So he was looking at the situation of Israel in their strange land. The behavior, he said that they turn away, only confusion, being disobedient, not listening, and not obeying the word of God. And sometimes we find ourselves in the same situation. We may be in a place, yes, it may not be our local assembly, may not be where people know us as Christians, and we seem that they are down our guards. We seem to do what we call on distasteful thing before the Lord Jesus Christ. But God always have a servant, he always have somebody to point out to us that we are not doing according to what the Lord had asked us to do. And we need to turn our life around, because just as he said, if he should come at this moment, what will you say? The Bible tells us that he said he would come like a thief in the night. He also described it as the lightning from the east to the west, so quick he would come. And sometimes we may think, even in ourselves, because we may not feel no illness in our body, that we are not ready, we will not die, and we can live up life until we get in our age. And when we recognize, as we will say, we die in bed, we will get serious with God. Who tells us that? No man knows when the Lord will call us home. No man knows when he would be bringing in his return. And here Daniel is looking at it. I want to share some commentary here with you. This book speaks about the end time, that is at the time immediately before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ to reign on earth. It is an important book. This also evident from the fact that the enemy attacks it again and again. It is perhaps the most attacked book of all Old Testament book. This is because the book contains many prophecies that were already fulfilled in the time when the Lord Jesus was on earth. An example of this we see in this, the rise of the four conservative world realms over which Daniel prophesied. Unbelief cannot accept that a prophet has predicted this so accurately. Now, what I'm saying here, the Old Testament always seems a book not even churches like to be in part of, because they're not seeing its significance. And this is what the writing is saying here. Many people don't like the Old Testament. They're not seeing it effective. They see it as sometimes as a troublesome book to their soul. But this Old Testament book would give us enlightenment in what is happening in today's world. We understand. So I just see why sometimes pastors don't want to take time out to teach from the Old Testament, showing the prophetic word from it. Brothers and sisters, it tells us here, it speaks about the subject of this chapter is the conduct of those who, as a result of God's judgment of his people, are in a foreign land, wherein the favor of God rests on them. The message is that obedience to God gives insight into his thoughts and also the power to act in accordance with them. This is future elaborate in the following chapter. Daniel and his friends are a picture of the faithful remnant of Israel in the end time. It is not a remnant in the land of God, but among the nation. That is how it will be in the great tribulation. The true believers in our days are also a remnant for God. They also live in an end time. It is about God finding in us something of the characteristic that should be found in the whole people. We see that in Daniel 1, Daniel's personal behavior is based on introduction to again insight into the whole book. Brothers and sisters, what is saying here? He's telling us here now that Daniel recognized that the book that he read belongs to God, and he need to obey it in order to find favor with God, to make sure that he is in tune with what God wants him to be. But we are still today, what I would say, separating certain part of the Bible, how we should go about living our Christian life. The whole Bible is for the whole man. In one essence, I say, basic instruction before living out. And what could we say? But we have to understand that we cannot separate. The Bible says we should not add, neither we should separate. And yet for all, we have seen men are taking pleasure in just teaching what they want and how they feel and who they want to hear it. Here are not what is happening here through the Word of God. I still want to read some information again to let us know. It speaks about the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. Right? Besiege Jerusalem. There is no way to escape from his grip because the Lord is behind this siege. This is not because Nebuchadnezzar is so strong, but because the Lord Adon, the sovereign ruler over all things, stand behind this siege. He must give his people into the hand of the enemy because all the previous means to make his people repent failed to have an effect. The third year of the reign of Jehoiakim is the year 606 BC. In that year, the transport of a number of nobles, including Daniel and his friends, takes place. What are you saying here? When we don't want to listen, God will put men and women there to besiege us, to torment us, and we will not understand that what God is saying to us is for us to repent. To repent from the things that we are doing wrong. Yet for us, we have not seen that coming out from any one of us today. We are still not listening to the word of God. We are still not doing what God is asking us to do. We are still going our own way and thinking that we are on top of things. We are not on top of things. God is teaching us. God is warning us. Yet for us, we are not listening to what God is saying. The second point of the program concerned food. The deported prince and nobles get other food. They should eat from the royal table. The spiritual meaning is that they must find the strength for their service in the product of Babylon on the method of Babylon. What is offered to them is attractive for the natural taste, but the trick behind it is that the Babylonian food will transform them into Babylonian people with Babylonian behavior. The food they eat speak of what they observe in their mind. Now, what that is saying unto us here? Many of us as Christians, again, that I'm saying, as a Christian, if we don't learn to read and study the Word of God, there is no way we will be able to understand the things of God. If we only speaking about taking care of the physical body, that's how our mind going to always be. That's how our spiritual life going to always be focusing on. This physical way of living, entertaining ourselves in the physical thing. Here we see that because of the trick behind the Babylonians, they was thinking that giving the Daniel that sort of food that he may eat, in essence that they can change his thoughts and behavior of what he really is. And I can go back to show you from the book of Genesis, and we can talk about the book of Exodus. We have seen the children of Israel, even when they spent all that time in Egypt, and when God have taken them out, and they have recognized that the food they was getting from Egypt was what we call testable to them. But now in the wilderness, and God is giving them manna, they grumble. They say it was better for them there because their mind and their whole thought was changed to the physical food and not thinking about the food that God has given to them. And God had also said unto them, he suffered them to hunger and feed them with manna that the father and none of them ever have, to show them that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Jesus Christ himself quoted unto Satan in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 4. And sometimes we seem to forget that. But here today, we are understanding there is no way we can survive the situation that is before us if we're not looking at what God is saying unto us. Brothers and sisters, I'm asking the question, are we ready? Are we ready for the situation that is rising before us? I'm looking at a situation that is presently before us, that war that's taking place in the Middle East. Brothers and sisters, that's not an easy war to be thinking about. And this is almost in the essence of when Daniel saw the time has come. The 70 years had passed and it's time for the children of Israel to return back unto their homeland. But he recognized that the children of Israel was not ready because they was disobedient. They was following strange gods. They was doing their own thing. And it's the same thing here today. If you ask many Christians about the event that is happening in the Middle East right now, they cannot give you a good episode of it. They don't have any understanding, any clue of what is going on. Because why many churches are not teaching from the prophetic word. We're speaking about from Isaiah to Daniel and come down to the minor prophets, showing that God is sending out a warning. Jesus Christ only speak about it in Matthew chapter 24. This is why he spoke and he told the disciples that when you see the desolation of abomination, speaking by the prophet Daniel, why did he spoke about it in the New Testament? Because it is significant for all of us to know. And then you have to go back now and look at what took place there. And then you will recognize the seriousness of what will be taking place. What we have seen now is going on in the Middle East there. When you look at the Palestine, the Hamas is busting through Israel. This is a desolation. Right? They're going on to what you call the promised land. They are outcasts. And look what they have done. And it's hard to the core to many of the Jews today to see what take place. And I don't want to argue it. Only God alone knows. Because in Daniel, he spoke about it. He said God is behind the siege. And God could be the one behind what is happening there to wake us up. Because when you think of who Israel are, and you look at what Israel stands for in this world, that everybody asking how something like that can happen. The most secure country in the world, in every way, technology, air, land and sea. And yet for all, they were caught flat-footed. And many Christians, this is the same thing can happen to you. When you think that it will not happen, it will happen. When I look where these people went and have that party, it was almost on the edge of the border. So there was no escape in the desert. Nobody thinking that they are living so close to the enemy. So they go ahead having a good time. And here the enemy attacked them and there is no way for many of them could have escaped. Over 260 were slaughtered there. And it was well planned, as they said. Because among the missile that they let go after, we have been up to the latest over 1,300 Jews have murdered. And as they are saying, never this had ever happened since after Israel became a nation in 1948, the 14th of May. Even the mark they have given towards that, after 50 years in 1973, Israel had an attack like that. 50 years is significant in the word of God. It talk about tribulation. It talk about jubilation. That is when the six nations rise up against Israel and Israel was able to defeat them. But instead of they were getting and giving God thanks and praise, as he said, they rise up to pray. But that is not all. We still have to go back and look and see what God is saying to us here today. We as Christians, yes, it may be happening to Israel now, but then what about us tomorrow? What about us tomorrow? Where will we stand? Because Israel is still a chosen nation, a chosen generation by God. He still looks after them. He said they are the apple of his eyes. And when you juke Israel, it's like you juke the eyes of God. So we don't know what the outcome may be at the last. So many things is happening to that, brothers and sisters. I can tell you that it reached to a point that many even looking at them, looking for one who would come up with a solution, which would tell us, send up a sign for us. This situation like that would come in the last days, that when men would be looking for someone with the answer and simply they would be accepting the Antichrist and don't even know that. Make a peace treaty with them. And when they think it's peace, sudden destruction. Brothers and sisters, what we are seeing going on out there, I would trust God that many of us will take time out to watch that news, follow the event. I want to say also, I have sinned against God. I apologize, and I apologize for many of us because God said to us, pray for the peace of Israel, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. But many of us don't do that. When we go to church, many of us is about our own self. And here we have seen Israel in a situation. If you look at the geographic point or state of Israel, you would recognize that Israel in a what you call between hard sea, the deep sea and a hard rock. Because around Israel is the enemy and out there is the deep sea. You look at Lebanon in the south. Yep. And you have Egypt and you have Syria in the north and the northeast. And the Saudi Arabia, all of them surround Israel. You have Iran and all of them. All these are the enemies. And yet that small strip of land is still a burdensome because God said, I will make you a burdensome to the world. And God also warned them, he said, don't boast, you know. It's not anything about you because I chose you. And God wants to show his might. We don't know what the end will be, but I trust God. I know the end of it. He never lost a battle. And I know he would win that battle. But the bottom line is, are we ready to see the, when he win that battle? Are we ready for when he touch and that mount? What are we doing? I always say to many of my folks, they always speak about this scripture. We must go out and preach this scripture. But that scripture that Jesus Christ speaks about in Matthew chapter 24, it was a warning not only to the unsaved, but to us as believers. He said it must be preached for a witness. That, so we have to watch this sign because he told them the end thereof. That when we notice certain signs, we know what is coming after. He said it's the same thing. When we see these signs, what we'll hear about war and rumors of war. Nation against nation. Kingdom against kingdom. And we have seen that boiling up and developing in such a place like right now. And what are we doing? Are we really ready? Are we ready to see his return? Brothers and sisters, we need to wake up. Even our small country here, we need to wake up. We need to get to understand there is something there. I remember early on in the year, I shared that probably here. I shared it in my church. I shared it on a platform, international platform, with my brother and all those who can remember, I shared it to them. I went out in the back of my land. In my land to wet my plants. And when I, for some reason, I looked up and I saw a star leaving the west and speeding to the east. And I asked, what sign is this? Never have seen that. A star leaving the west and it's like speed going to the east. And me and my brothers discussed and I said, I seen there is a fireball on the horizon to have an impact on this earth. And brothers and sisters, it may not be exactly what is happening now. I don't know if it is worse because the year don't end. But what happened in Israel, just wake me up and show me that God was showing me something significant. Because we're hearing now that the war, the attack that Israel have gotten, they have never gotten something like that in their whole life. And the attack they are putting on Afghanistan and the Palestine now, the Palestine have never seen something like that in their whole lifetime. Brothers and sisters, there is signs in the air. There is something that we need to wake up. Oh, brothers and sisters, let me say to us, yeah, these things are so serious. Even when that attack took place in Israel there was also an earthquake in Afghanistan. Over 2,000 people dead. And that could not have even bring the headline news. Because why? There is something in Israel. There is something there, which I will share later on, that is significant, that whether men and women don't want to believe, Arabs, Jews, Rastafarian, or whosoever don't want to believe that Israel is a significant aspect in God's prophetic word. As he said, that is his chosen one. And we can do what we want. We have to accept it. Because that's the only place that when some destabilization is taking place, the whole world pay attention to. When this thing happened, I went and watched news from in Japan, in China, in India, wheresoever I can. I pick up and everybody had something to say about that war and it was troubling to them because they don't know the outcome of it. They look at this war can trouble every man and woman and child on this earth. And you tell me that God's word is not true? You tell me that God's word is not significant? Daniel spoke of the last days, right? And he could not have seen what it's like because God tells him to seal it up. Revelation is the one that reveals it. And when you read into the book of Revelation, it speaks about making people scared. They don't want to teach them in church. No, we as Christians should rejoice when we see what is coming upon the face of the earth is already taking place in heaven because this tumor was transformed into heaven to see what already is taking place there. It's already taking place in heaven. It is just a manifest on earth. But God don't want to manifest it on and what is it to us. He wants us to be ready. That is why I'm asking if we are ready. He wants to manifest it here. Don't only know that we are ready to for his second coming. John wanted to shut the book. He said no. That's the last book. That's the last warning I'll be sending out. And John saw everything what will be taking place. The plague. He talk about the mark of the beast. He talk about money will be thrown in the street. He talk about the destruction. Men will be cursing. Men will want to dead and they cannot dead. They run into the mountain. Mountain running from man. The sea giving up water. This is the time. What will be coming? Jesus Christ will not come back when the earth is at peace. Jesus Christ coming back when this earth is in turmoil to call his people home. And that is why he said, when I come back, will I find faith? Will I find faith? Because the situation will be so difficult. It will be so tense that many would be failing away. Faith. They would lose hope. They would lose faith. And it's surprising to so even in the church, because he said there will be a falling away even in the church. Brothers and sisters, I don't want to get nobody scared. But all I want us to do, to get ready. Those of you who don't know the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, asking you to run into the ark of safety before it's too late. He died upon the cross for the reason, a reason for that. So that when you accept him, because Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man coming to the Father but by me. Nothing else would get us away from the situation that is at hand and what is to come. Only the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Only who have his name written on the forehead would escape such a judgment. Brothers and sisters, it is coming. We can say what we want. It is coming. Amen. Father in heaven, I thank you today for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your word. I thank you, O God, Lord, as you have me to speak, O God, Father, Lord, letting the people know that we need to get ready. Lord, right about now, if we walk around our environment, we know that we are not ready for your second coming. But that does not hold back, God, your prophetic word from being fulfilled, because everything with you have a time limit, right? You is unlimited in time, but you give every man a time to repent. Lord, you said, oh God, you allow, oh God, Israel to go and to be besieged because you want them to repent. Father, I pray, oh God, Lord, help us to understand that the situation that we're in is to help us to repent before you come, oh God, Father, Lord. Lord, each and every one of us, oh God, Lord, that we can turn to you before it's too late. Father, I pray today, Lord, that you turn man's heart towards you, because the essence of Satan is to separate man from God. But God, you kissing your son that you died upon because that we he can redeem us and give us that opportunity. He said we can come boldly before the throne. We can cry, Abba, Father. And Father, I pray, O God, Lord, that it can happen today. Help us, Lord, that we acknowledge, O God, your word and your prophetic word that is manifesting itself before us today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you for your listening. Amen and amen.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.